First, I just wanted to express my appreciation for having the opportunity to come and speak with all of you and for you all to take the time out of your evenings to come and be a part of such a fabulous community to make space to learn, support one another. I really appreciate the mission of this organization. So tonight I'll be speaking about mindfulness. And to put this in context a little bit, I've been a DPT therapist for, I'd say, close to 7 years now. And my knowledge of mindfulness has really come from more of a clinical perspective. Others practice more from a religious perspective. It's got roots in Zen Buddhism. Others practice mindfulness in a Christian context. For tonight, at least, I'd like to keep it more in a practical term of how can this supplement clinical practice for those who are in therapy, and how can this just be a part of a lifestyle for those who have characteristics of borderline personality disorder, or those of you who love and support somebody who does. So please do feel free to ask questions at the end, or if you want some clarification during any of this, let me know. So we'll start with the objectives for tonight. I'd like to provide a definition of mindfulness, describe the benefits of mindfulness practice, especially related to characteristics of borderline personality disorder, and suggest ways that you can practice. Now, knowing myself as I do, it's likely that I'll go on tangents at certain points, and if there are certain things that seem more interesting and relevant, I'll try to highlight those for all of you. So we'll practice non-attachment to the slides while keeping our objectives in mind. So first, a definition of mindfulness. What is it? Jon Kabat-Zinn has been one of the people, one of the leaders in bringing mindfulness to more of Western practice, especially through a medical model. One of the first to bring it into psychology, especially related to pain management. And his description is, mindfulness is paying attention in a sustained and particular way, on purpose, in the present moment, and non-judgmentally. Now, for more of a Zen Buddhist perspective, Thich Nhat Hanh says, mindfulness is the practice of being fully present and alive, body and mind united. An interesting perspective, because are the mind and the body really so separate? Where is the mind? If you had to point to it, where would you point? Really, it's about consciousness. And a final one of my personal favorites. So when I was a graduate student in Milwaukee, I went to a mindfulness center, went to some weekly practices, 9 o'clock on Saturday mornings, which is relevant, you'll see. And we had a teacher who would say, mindfulness is not about relaxation. You may feel the urge to fall asleep, but really it's the process of falling awake to the present moment, to your experience. Became relevant when we did body scans lying on soft mats on the floor at 10 a.m. with soft morning light coming in the windows. There were some snores in the room. So you may find mindfulness practice to be relaxing, but that's not ultimately the goal. The goal is to be as fully awake to the present moment as possible. So just some other thoughts on the nature of mindfulness. It's really a process of bringing intention to your life versus automaticity. I think we live our lives to a great extent through habit, through repetition, through pattern. And while some of that is okay, some of that is necessary, it's just the nature of our work and family lives. Part of it is just bringing intention to it, being aware of, even when there's repetition, how is each moment unique? So it's similar to meditation. You may sometimes hear those words interchangeably, mindfulness and meditation. They are very closely related, but the way I think about the difference is mindfulness is more portable. Meditation, you may do sitting. Sometimes the goal is described as emptying the mind. For mindfulness, it's something that you can do no matter where you are, no matter what you're doing. It can be mindfulness of doing the dishes, of walking, of talking to a loved one, of drinking coffee. It's more of an active process that can go with you throughout your life. The goal really is to take a step back and observe, to, I would say dialectically, for those of you who know dialectics, I am a DBT clinician after all, it's a goal of both being able to fully throw yourself into and participate in the present moment, but also have the flexibility to take a step back and watch it. If you picture a stream, being able to both swim in the stream at times and at times take a step back from the shore and watch it go by without being swept away by the current. This is especially relevant for those of us who are emotionally sensitive. So when it comes to mindfulness of thoughts, a big focus is not trying to fight or change what your mind does, but just to notice it, bring compassion to it, make space for it. This is true for emotions as well. It's easier to do when emotions and thoughts are pleasant, to make room for them. When they're painful, it's one of the most difficult things to have the willingness to do it. Another thing I want to say is, if you picture it like a camera with a zoom lens, you want to have the flexibility to broaden your awareness, take a panoramic view, and at times zoom in to just one thing, just one aspect of your experience. So one common practice is to really mindfully observe the breath, and that's focusing in on one specific thing. But if that's the only mindfulness practice you ever have, there may be parts of your life where you could generalize that into more of an active practice to be able to put that into relationships, into work, into talking to a loved one. So that's when you broaden your awareness to take in a fuller context. Another thing I want us to be talking about is the difference between doing and being. I would say in our society, we get really caught up in doing, not so much in being. So I borrowed this first point from Jon Kabat-Zinn, who talks a lot about doing versus being. He says something along the lines of, this is paraphrased, but we can get so caught up in activity that we can get busy doing and forget who is doing the doing. And you don't want to lose yourself in activity and habit. Otherwise, it can feel like life is just one to-do list after another, one task after another. And if you don't make space for being, it can feel like there's just not much richness in your life. For those who take the tea, I think you'll notice we as a society are addicted to stimulation. When there's downtime, when there's nothing actively going on, what's the first thing we do? Pull out the iPhone and play Angry Birds or Candy Crush. There's not much space for stillness, for reflection. We try to fill every moment with activity, with distraction. And at times it's helpful. It really is. Sometimes it's helpful to keep our minds occupied. It can help cope with distress, but at other times, it's important to be able to have comfort with stillness and figure out what's actually there when you take away all of the distractions and just take a look at what happens in your mind. One other point, when life feels repetitive, it may be a red flag to do some reflection and see if you're actually missing some of the richness and uniqueness of each day and each moment. I can say as a therapist doing DBT, you do DBT for 7 years and you can start to feel like, okay, we're doing session one again, we're teaching the skills again. But if you take a step back and really look at the uniqueness, the way you teach the skills, the way you apply the skills, the way it fits into each individual's life is very different. So when you delve into it, you can see there really is no moment that's exactly like any other moment, and it can really help to enrich your life, take care of boredom, take care of repetition when you can see the richness of every moment. So beginner's mind, one of my favorites as someone who's a so-called expert on mindfulness. So a favorite quote of mine, in the beginner's mind, there are many possibilities. In the expert's, there are few. I think the spirit of this message is sometimes when we think we know, we forget to look, we forget to reflect and take in what actually might surprise us. for those of you who know the concept of schemas, it's like a roadmap for a situation, how we understand patterns. Schemas are helpful. They help us cope with situations, but sometimes we fit schemas onto things that they don't fit. So sometimes thinking we know keeps us from actually deeply knowing. I see often on our unit, girls come in. We work with adolescent girls, about 13 to 20 or so. A lot of them come in and say, DBT is not going to work. I already know that this is just not going to work. Nothing's going to work for me. And I think what they're really speaking to is a really deep fear and sadness about not having had those things work in the past. But what I try to help people understand is we can't know. I can't tell you that DBT will work any more than someone can say that it won't work until we try it. What I try to encourage people to do is just open their minds to the not knowingness. Allow reality to flow how it's going to flow. So, little illustration, beginner's mind. What does a penny actually look like? How many thousands of times in your life have you seen a penny? How many times have you actually looked closely? I think we get the concept of what a penny looks like, and because we think we know what a penny looks like, how often do we actually look? Who thinks it's the first one? No one, maybe one. Second, number three, four. It's actually number three. It's kind of a funny thing. And my point is not that we all need to go out and memorize what our change looks like, or that you need to be aware of counting how many steps are in a staircase and really take in every detail of your environment. The point is more along the lines of let go of the assumption that we know and allow for some humility that sometimes we might think we know more than we actually know and make space for observing where we might be surprised. So for those of us who remember the 80s, this is the board game Othello, which I think has one of the all-time best taglines, a minute to learn, a lifetime to master. I'm borrowing it for tonight. I think it really applies to mindfulness. I can describe to you in an hour or less what mindfulness is and how you can practice. But really, you could spend your lifetime trying to really get to know your mind, befriend it, and practice mindfulness in a way that's meaningful. And if you do delve into this, if you do choose to take this journey, you'll see that day after day, year after year, your understanding of mindfulness changes and adapts to the stage that you're at. So that being said, how do we practice mindfulness? A little bit of a trick answer. With a spirit of humor, humility, gentleness, curiosity, and non-attachment. I really think this is important because sometimes when we think about mindfulness and meditation, it can seem like drudgery. It can seem very serious. It can seem like you sit on a cushion and contemplate. You ask deep questions that don't have answers. But really, the way I think about mindfulness, it's got a lot more to do with playfulness, with openness, with a spirit of joy and compassion and love, making space for both the good and the bad in life, but really just a spirit of acceptance. And I think anyone who undertakes a mindfulness practice will inevitably get frustrated. Have you all heard of the phrase monkey mind before? It's a common experience. And an apt description that the mind can be like a monkey swinging from branch to branch of trees. As much as you would like for it to have stillness, we all sometimes suffer from monkey mind. And if you try to tame your mind, if you try to control it and force your mind to be empty, and you practice that in a rigid way, you're bound to be frustrated. So you have to practice this with a spirit of compassion towards yourself. We often ask ourselves the question when we're practicing mindfulness, am I doing it right? Am I mindful yet? Have I reached the higher level of mindfulness? And as soon as you're asking those questions, you're striving for something in a black or white way. And really, it's all about befriending your mind, knowing your mind, which we never fully can. It's like carrying a flashlight around in a dark room. You can pinpoint areas of it, but you can never fully know your own mind. So that's where the humility and humor comes in. So since we are here for NEA-BPD, everyone in the room, I imagine, has an interest in borderline personality disorder. And I want to make sure we're paying attention to how mindfulness relates to BPD. So I imagine these bullet points look familiar. It's a list of the DSM criteria for borderline personality disorder, just so that we're all on the same page about what we're talking about with BPD. If we boil it down, it's got a lot to do with difficulties in relationships, sense of self, intense emotions, difficulty controlling them, really a lot of pain, isolation, hopelessness, fear. And I do think that mindfulness really does help a lot of people maybe not end pain, but at least escape suffering. And I'll get to the distinction between those as we move on. So why mindfulness? In part because I think it's so essential to therapy to develop awareness. If you don't have awareness of your mind and how it works, it can feel like you're pulled around by your emotions. You're not the driver of the bus anymore. I'm sure many have heard this analogy before, but your emotions become the driver of the bus, and you can feel like you're at the mercy of your mood on any given day. Someone asks, you know, will you do this task tomorrow? The answer, honestly, might be, well, it depends on how I feel tomorrow. So part of developing awareness is putting yourself more in a position of being able to control and predict how you're going to be from one day to the next. Second point is habits are very hard to break, any kind of habits. But in order to break a habit, it really takes an intentional practice of bringing awareness to break that automaticity. And the benefits of increasing emotional awareness, especially with our teenagers on the 3 East unit, we see that a lot of them have a lot of difficulty labeling, describing, and communicating what they're actually feeling. And being able to understand and put words to your experience is such a powerful thing, to be able to self-validate and also communicate that to others in a way that they might better understand. And in order to do that, you have to really observe what's going on within your mind, within your body, to be able to put words to it accurately. The other thing that I see, even this week we had a new girl come in and say, I don't know why I get angry, it just comes out of the blue for no reason. My emotions don't have causes, they just happen. And it is possible that this is true, but in my experience, more often than not, emotions do have causes whether we're aware of them or not. And the more you can practice awareness of lower level emotions, you might detect them before they get to the intense, almost unmanageable level. And I think it makes it seem like more of a solvable problem, because what do you do to solve the problem of my emotions come out of nowhere? But if you figure out that there was actually a cue there, like maybe there was a thought, a fear that led to the emotion, that's actually something that we can tackle in therapy. So it makes it much more workable. And finally, mindfulness can increase the ability to tolerate painful emotions. It increases pain tolerance in terms of physical pain, but it's fascinating. It also works for emotional pain. And when you can learn to make space for pain, to tolerate it, there's less of a need to rely on things that numb out emotions, shut them down, avoids them. You can, in a way, befriend even the painful emotions, or at least allow them to be a part of your experience. Invite them along with you on the journey. And we'll get to the final point on here in a second, that it actually can keep your thoughts from revving up your emotions even more when you can mindfully observe them. So for these reasons, mindfulness is considered the core skill of dialectical behavior therapy. In part, like I was saying, because of the spirit of acceptance, I think it's absolutely essential to have a spirit of acceptance in any kind of therapy. And I mentioned briefly the difference between pain and suffering. So the way we think about it in DBT, pain is inevitable. You can't be human without sometimes having pain, both physical and emotional. It's part of the human experience. But suffering on a deeper level can be lessened, it can be avoided sometimes if you can make space for the pain. So the difference can be, instead of feeling rage, you can find a way to feel and accept and express anger. Instead of terror, fear instead of despair, sadness. And that can be the most powerful difference. It can make it feel like you can have your emotions but still be in control. And what can keep pain from turning into suffering is mindful awareness and acceptance, allowing the pain to exist, validating it, seeing it as a natural part of life, maybe even getting some support from others around it if you can communicate it. The second point, using skills unmindfully just doesn't work. So let's say we're teaching a girl to go and distract by watching a TV show in order to cope with urges. If she's watching that TV show and the whole time thinking, I cannot believe my mother said that, I'm so furious, it doesn't actually work. You're not really distracting if your mind is still stuck on that thing. So the more mindfulness you can bring to your skills use, regardless of what the skill is, the more effective it's going to be. It also helps us get into wise mind. It's one of the DBT skills. Wise mind is where logic and emotion intersects, and both are essential. Both give us information. We need both to really reach wisdom and a deep sense of knowing and intuition. And mindfulness allows us to have solvable problems, like I was saying before. It's not uncommon for me to ask one of our residents, what are you feeling? What emotion are you feeling? And the response be suicidal. And my thought is, suicidal, technically not an emotion. Suicidal is a thought that you have that's actually a solution that you've come to solve the problem of an emotion or an interpersonal dilemma. And when someone comes and says, I'm just suicidal, I don't know why, there's no reason I'm always suicidal, unless we can trace that back to, well, why? What's the problem you're trying to solve? It's hard to get a grip on that. It's hard to really take a look at it. So mindfulness allows us to really explore why, where is this coming from? What can we do about it? Okay, so some DBT skills. Here's how we teach in a practical way how to practice mindfulness. So we have the what skills and the how skills. The what is, what do you do in order to practice mindfulness? And we teach people to observe, describe, and participate. Observe is with the five senses, just take it in. So for example, if you have, okay, this is not tea, I wish it were. If you have a hot cup of tea, to just take it in with the five senses. This is a practice of focusing in your attention on just one thing. So you would smell the aroma, feel the warmth of the cup, feel the weight of the cup in your hands. Really just focus your mind on one thing. Now, is it an important life skill to really pay attention to drinking tea? Maybe, maybe not. But it can really benefit you to train your mind to be able to do that. Because when it comes to being able to really observe an emotion or practice this in order to keep your mind here, instead of going to, as you see the gentleman here in the cartoon, everything. I'm sure most of us have had that experience of the mind jumbled with so many things. To have the discipline of being able to focus in on just one thing is so powerful. So observe is just noticing with the five senses. Describe is one step up from that, to be able to put words to your experience, to label it, to express it. And this has such a powerful interpersonal function, because let's say I've been able to really observe the feeling of sadness within myself. What do I do with that if I want someone to understand and validate that? I have to be able to put words to it. I have to be able to understand it for myself, but also help others understand it. So that's where being able to really accurately put words to it is important. And when we're describing as a mindfulness skill, you're leaving out judgment, interpretation, anything other than just the facts of the situation. And finally, participate. Participate, I think, is ultimately the goal, to be able to throw yourself into your experience 100%, distract from self-consciousness, but really be fully present. Ironically, like our little dog friend here is, he's being much more mindful than his human friend. Talk a little bit more about participation. So when you can fully participate, even when you feel like you've got a life that is drudgery, misery, pain all the time, if you try to fully participate in little things, you might find moments of joy. So even on a bad day, you might drink your coffee in the morning and notice even a second of enjoyment of the flavor of the coffee. It's all about being able to put yourself in your current experience. Maybe in that moment when you're drinking your coffee, nothing bad is actually happening. Maybe you're remembering something bad that has happened or fearing something bad will happen, but in that particular moment, maybe nothing bad is actually happening. And if you fully participate in the flavor of the coffee, even that little bit of respite in a bad day can make a difference. So as I said before, it's easier to do this with pleasant events. It's much harder to participate in sadness, grief, mourning, fear, but ultimately it's important to do both. So the next set of skills is the how skills. So how do you practice mindfulness? First one is one mindfully. I'm not sure if you can read this cartoon here, but it says multitasking, screwing up several things at once. So a little judgment in there, but I think the point is when we try to do multiple things at once, it detracts from our subjective experience of what it feels like to be doing those things, and it also makes us less efficient and accurate when we're doing those things. It's different from what a lot of businesses say. A lot of organizations will want to hire someone who's a good multitasker. There really aren't very many of them out there in the world. I am certainly not one of them. It costs something in terms of your efficiency and how much energy your mind is putting in when you switch back and forth between tasks and try to do multiple things at once, like a computer running too many programs. So what we try to do is practice just one thing in the moment. If you're walking, walk. If you're sleeping, sleep. If you're talking to somebody, talk. If you're eating, eat. But what you don't want to do is walk and ruminate or talk to somebody and think about your cell phone bill. What you really want to do is just be in that moment doing that task. It's a little bit of an extreme example, but Marsha Linehan, the creator of DBT, gave us this example once that when you're walking, whether you're walking to the gallows or whether you're walking to accept a major award, when you're walking, just be walking. Your emotional experience, if it's different between the two, you're in the future, you're not in the present moment. Now, practically speaking, I can't imagine any of us would fully feel that way. But the spirit of it is, when you are walking, walk. Find those moments when you can just do one thing and not be in the past or the future. The second one is non-judgmentally. We try to be non-judgmental of ourselves, of our experience, of others, in part because it frees us up to see more accurately and see solvable problems. So if one of our residents comes to me and says, I'm going to fail out of school because I'm stupid. Stupid's a judgment, and it's also not a solvable problem. How do you solve stupid? But if we break that down to, I have trouble paying attention when I do my homework, I get so anxious, I can't perform well on my tests, those are solvable problems. That's non-judgmental, that's description, that's factual. The final one is effectively. So when we're being effective, we're doing just what's needed in the moment. Not getting caught in being right, but doing what works. So Boston driving has taught me this one. It's been such an abundant lesson to me. Because I grew up in areas where we follow the rules of the road much more closely than Boston drivers do. So I find myself sometimes in situations where I know what the rules of the road would say. I know that I am right. But if I were to follow the rules of the road, I'm going to get run over. So sometimes you have to do what's effective. You have to figure out, does it make sense for me to be rigid and say, no, I'm going to go because it's my right of way? And, you know, the officer can congratulate you on your good driving after the accident. Or do you do what's effective and really take in, like I was saying, broaden your awareness to take in the situation that you're in and do what works? One other aspect of mindfulness that I think we don't talk about as much, but it's really important, is a sense of connection. As I was saying, in our society, we look for constant stimulation, But also a lot of people end up feeling very isolated because we don't have that stillness. We don't have that chance to really commune with one another. So finding a sense of connection, especially for people who experience loneliness, emptiness, you can find a sense of connection to the universe. You can find it through religion. Some people find it through nature, being a part of a community. But really, it's an internal practice of seeing yourself as not just being a single organism, but being a part of a greater whole. And it can take some work to cultivate this practice, but it can actually decrease feelings of isolation. As an example, a couple of years ago, I went to a silent mindfulness retreat for, I'd say, 3 or 4 days. I can't remember exactly. But throughout this long weekend, there were maybe 10 people that sat in a room silently. We didn't speak a word to one another. We sat silently. We were instructed not to make eye contact, even if we could avoid it, because it was about self-reflection. The most fascinating thing to me was by the end of the retreat, we all felt a sense of community with one another. We felt a sense of knowing and belonging with one another without even exchanging names. And I think it says something about when you really get into your humanness and feel this sense of connection, it's not about the superficial things like, where are you from? What's your name? Do you have a dog? It's about sharing this human condition. And even the feeling of loneliness. If you can acknowledge loneliness is a universal human experience, that when you are feeling lonely, isolated, there are millions of other people in the world at that given moment probably feeling the same thing. Whether that gives you a sense of connection or not, at least it can make it seem less foreign, less alien. And I put the question at the bottom, why try to cultivate a connection to nature? I've seen this one be important for people who experience a lot of shame and feelings of undeservingness, because nature and animals don't discriminate. They don't judge. They don't say you're less than, you're not good enough. If you imagine walking through a forest and the sunlight is shining down on trees and squirrels and even on you as you walk through, is the squirrel more deserving of the sunlight than you? The sunlight falls on everything the same. It doesn't acknowledge shame. It doesn't think about deservingness. Nature is there for all of us without judgment. And for some people, that is how they feel the sense of acceptance and connection, especially those who don't have an organized religion, a spiritual practice where there's a God of any sort. Sometimes just connection to nature serves a similar, similar function. Okay, so how can this play out in relationships and trying to improve relationships with others? Practicing mindfulness can reduce reactivity because you take out judgment, you take out assumptions, interpretations of behavior, and for those who are familiar with mentalization, this may sound very familiar. So what you're doing is introducing flexibility without saying, I absolutely know this person is doing this thing for this reason. It can really help you communicate openly with others. So as an example, let's imagine you have a date planned with your significant other and he or she is an hour late and hasn't called. Can you imagine how the interpretation you make of that event can really affect your emotional state? Let's say your interpretation is, oh, he must have gotten caught up at work, poor guy. You know, I bet he's gonna be tired when he gets home. You might feel compassion. If your interpretation is, he doesn't love me anymore, what if he's with another woman? It'd be a very different emotional reaction. I'm not saying we know which is true, but really the practice is not knowing, allowing that you might not know, letting go of certainty. So mindfulness can also improve your ability to communicate your experience accurately. And I think we all understand how important validation is. When you can feel validated and understood, it helps everyone stay more regulated. It helps relationships become more intimate and close and accepting. So if I can make a recommendation, for those of you who have loved ones that you're going to be seeing soon, turn off all the other distractions, even for a few minutes, and just practice mindfully listening or being listened to I think a lot of our conversations happen while we're doing other things, watching TV, making a meal. But you can have a very different type of conversation with someone and feel more seen and heard if you can turn off everything else and just focus mindfully listening. So let's revisit this cartoon that we had up a second ago. Let's imagine instead of that dog, that's your loved one. That's a son, a daughter, a significant other who's trying to say something to you. And let's say you're even trying to listen, but in the background you have all of these things going on in your mind. Can you really hear accurately, deeply, the other person if your own mind isn't quiet? Sometimes uncluttering your own mind can really make a big difference in intimacy. Right, so how is this important for emotional dysregulation? We teach the skill of mindfulness of current emotion. That's what that acronym is at the beginning. Being able to ride the wave of an emotion. I think for a lot of people, especially those who are very sensitive and experience emotions intensely, you can start to feel an emotion rising and panic and think, I have to shut this down now. I can't tolerate this. If I let this emotion in, it's going to overtake me and it'll never stop. So part of the skill is, like I said before, feeling sadness without feeling despair, allowing yourself to ride that wave of emotion, let it come and go naturally without fighting it, without engaging in a behavior to shut it down, just making room for it. And part of that is not judging it. So thoughts like, this will never get better, this is hopeless, I always feel this way, those are judgments. They're not actually facts, because there may be other times when you haven't felt exactly that particular way. Or in the future, maybe you won't feel that particular way. And sometimes when you're caught up in an emotion, it can give you some relief to remind yourself, this will end. This emotion may change. It may shift. I can't know that this is always going to be this way. So when you practice mindfulness, it can short-circuit those thought spirals that can keep an emotion going and keep it intensifying over time. And it may help with identifying emotions sooner so that you don't get to that point where you're in complete dysregulation, but you recognize it, the early signs, and you can validate it and work on it then. It's a lot more workable the sooner you can catch an emotion. So we also teach the skill of urge surfing. You guys be willing to practice something with me. This is all about noticing when you have an urge to engage in a behavior and just watching that urge, the way it might come up, come down, intensify, but without acting on the urge. I don't know why that's a panda, by the way, but I thought it was cute. So for, let's say, even 30 seconds. This is winter, the time of dry skin and wool sweaters. I think we could all find an itch somewhere on our bodies if we really look. So if you're all willing to participate, take a second to scan your body, see if there's any part of your body that has an itch. Just notice. Some people find one. Now for a few seconds, I want you to focus in your attention just on the itch. Don't distract from it and try not to scratch it. Just notice what it feels like to have an itch and not scratch it. We have some itchy people in the audience. If you really want to scratch your itch, you can. So an itch is a pretty innocuous thing, but when it comes to urges for things like substance use or self-injury, it's so important to be able to recognize you can have an urge, even a very intense one, and make the choice to ride it out and just notice that urge without having to act on it. Of course, an itch is a lot harder to ignore. How does this relate to thoughts? So the key is recognizing thoughts as thoughts, because sometimes they can feel like facts. When you're really stuck in it, and you think it's always going to be this way, that feels factual. It's hard to argue with that when you're really in it. But if you can see the difference between the thought, I'm an awful human being, versus saying to yourself, I'm noticing I'm having shame, I'm having the thought that I am awful, but actually I don't know if I have evidence to support or refute that. It creates a little bit more flexibility in there. If you can just not be certain, it gets you a little unglued from the emotion. It gives you some room to work with it. So you see our cartoon here. Once again, a man and a dog. I think dogs and children are supremely mindful. I really respect them for that. But the man is having so many thoughts. Who, what, where, when, how, why. I've never met an existential dog. And I think it's really a gift. It's a beautiful thing that we as human beings can reflect on our own minds and how they work, that we can wonder, that we can question, that we can think about the future and the past. But sometimes the trap is, because we can do that, because we have abstract thought, we can imagine a reality different from ours. And sometimes that creates pain, thinking about how things could have been different or could be different in the future. So really what I would invite you to do is practice just noticing thoughts as thoughts, label them as that. When you have a self-judgment, notice it as a thought, not a fact. So the most classic form of mindfulness is a sitting mindfulness. The gorilla here has very good position. So you want to sit in an open body posture because mentally it allows for openness. It allows for your experience to be what it is. If you are very closed off like this, it's much harder to be accepting of whatever your experience is. So you want to sit in an open posture, palms open if that's comfortable. And really the key is to just notice your sensations. If you're choosing your breath, that's a grounding thing. If your mind starts to wander, if your monkey mind, a little bit of a pun with the gorilla, unintended. If you have monkey mind, as we all do at times, use your breath as a grounding thing to bring your mind back to just this moment. Or you can do it with the sensations of your body against the chair, your feet against the floor. That you can choose something to focus your mind back on to keep it from wandering. Another thought I had here, if you judge yourself for your mind wandering, be prepared to do a lot of self-judgment because our minds are just designed that way. That's the nature of minds to wander. It's what they do. So have some compassion, and when you notice your mind has wandered from the practice you're doing, whether that's breathing or drinking tea, just notice. Notice that your mind has drifted and very gently, compassionately bring it back to what you're trying to focus on. So one of my favorite practices is noticing the breath because it is always there. It's with you no matter where you are. You can always use that. So we have a few different suggestions for breathing practices that we teach on our unit at 3 East. Paced breathing really helps with anxiety because if you've noticed when you're anxious, your breathing speeds up and gets very fast, very shallow. So paced breathing can help to slow and more make your breathing more regular. Now notice that this is actually a practice of altering your breathing versus just noticing your breathing. So it really depends on what goal you're trying to accomplish, whether it's just acceptance and openness or if you're trying to have something to focus your mind. Sometimes counting breath, doing things like this to alter the way your breathing is can really help focus the mind when otherwise thoughts might drift too much for that particular practice. Box breathing is another one that I'll briefly describe. So box breathing is, I'm going to have to do a visual aid here. So on the in breath, you breathe in to a certain count, I'll say 3. So breathe in, 2, 3, hold 3 counts, hold 2, 3, exhale 2, 3, hold 2, 3. Did I get that right for those who know it? Yeah, so really it's also slowing down your breath and focusing in your mind on the sensations of the breathing. So for thoughts, there are a few things that you can do to kind of get yourself unstuck from your thoughts. Some people do visualization around this of seeing the thoughts in your mind on a conveyor belt or putting it on a leaf on a stream and watching it drift, because otherwise what the mind does is it takes a thought and grips on tightly and wants to explore it and jump from that to another related thought. So if there's a way that you can let go of the thoughts, let them just come and go, picture them going up like a bubble popping or a little poof of smoke. Somehow just visualize something that lets you let it go. Another favorite of mine is sorting into boxes. So for those of us who get caught in the past and the future, what you can do is practice for a few minutes just seeing what your mind does. And every time you notice having a thought, place it in one of three boxes: past, present, future. And you might notice something about which you tend to do more of. Body scan is good for people who find this relaxing or comforting. It's also something that you always have with you. You never go anywhere without your body. So even if you just have a few minutes in between meetings, at the grocery store, you can find a second to notice, what are the sensations in my stomach? What are the sensations in my chest? It can help you notice if you have early signs of an emotion. You might not notice feeling an emotion, but you might feel tightness in your chest and recognize, oh, maybe there's something going on there I should pay attention to. And for those who are too busy for mindfulness, who isn't? I think we all have that thought sometimes. But mindfulness is such a portable thing. It doesn't have to take a lot of time. You don't have to do an hour-long sitting mindfulness. And it can actually increase your efficiency throughout the day for those who have a really serious to-do list. I like to compare that to tuning your instrument before playing a symphony, that you could have a mind like a million-dollar Stradivarius, but if it's off tune, you're just not going to perform as well. So sometimes taking even a very short time, 2 minutes at the beginning of the day, to check in with yourself, tune into yourself, tune into those around you, can actually make you much more efficient and connected and effective throughout the day. So you can choose things to remind you to practice mindfulness. Some people will set alarms on their iPhones or smartphones. Some people will do things like remind yourself every time you're driving and you get to a red light. Use that as a cue to take 3 or 4 mindful breaths. Even that makes a difference. Mindfulness is about practice. It actually alters your brain when you practice over time. So the more you can do it, the more you can even take a few seconds. You're training your mindfulness muscle in a way. You get better at it. Also choose something that you do anyway, like the dishes or laundry or walking, driving, talking to somebody. My favorite is mindfully doing therapy sessions, because what therapists don't often tell you is therapy is a great gift to therapists. It can be a really powerful experience to mindfully just be in that room with another human being. If you're having a therapy session and your mind is on the last session or a phone call that you have to make or anything like that, it just doesn't feel good. It doesn't feel good to you or to the patient. So it's one of my favorites. It's something I'm going to do anyway. Why not do it mindfully? Why not really focus in on that moment? So again, I just wanted to say thank you all for having me here, for taking a moment to really think about and learn about mindfulness. I hope you'll all give some thought to how you might do this in your lives, and I'd invite any questions. Yes, there are 4 skills components. There's core mindfulness, which really is pervasive throughout everything. You do everything mindfully. There's also distress tolerance, emotion regulation, and interpersonal effectiveness skills. So all of those work together, but like I said, none of them work as well if you're not doing them mindfully. That's the core.
Any strategies that you might have?
Well, there could be a couple of reasons that's happening. It could be that even despite your effort to just ride it out, there are things that are re-triggering it in the moment. So let's say it's the emotion of sadness. It's really hard to just feel the pit in your stomach, the urge to cry, the knot in your throat. It's hard to just focus on that without having thoughts about why the sadness is there. And sometimes having the thoughts about why the sadness is there keeps the sadness going. And sometimes that even happens without even noticing. So if you're finding that that's part of the reason, you can take a moment to do something else like distract and revisit it later, because the sadness may still be there. You can still ride the wave later. The other thought is the intensity just may be too high at that moment, because like I said, sometimes these things happen, they work better if you catch it sooner. So if we think about sadness being a scale of 0 to 10, if you're trying to practice riding the wave when your sadness is at a 9 or a 10, it's going to be really hard to let it just go like that at that point, because it's already gone on to the point that it's been ramped up. So it could be that in that moment, that's not the particular skill to use. Maybe there's something else that can bring down the intensity first, and then when it's closer to like a 6 or a 7, practice